What's up, scavengers? I hope you are all as excited as I am for the upcoming ant season. Or if you are from the southern hemisphere, hope you're all having a great one. If you want, please tell me what queens you have caught in this season. I'm actually really curious on what species is common or rare down there in the southern hemisphere. Well, with that said, let's get into the video, because I am so excited for this one. My Swedish native ant queens have been in hibernation for half a year, from September to early March. That is 6 cold and long months. Now you might understand my cravings for a non-hibernating species, which we will come to later. And the reason why if I have my exotic ants escape, they will all die from the extreme winter cold. Now, however, that long wait is finally over, and I took them out of hibernation. All winter, they have been in my outside food storage, which has had the same temperature as the surrounding ground. This means that inside the food storage, there was the temperatures that the ants would have experienced in the wild, since they are very locally caught. Always try to mimic your species' natural habitat, as it is just much better. After that, I brought them into the fridge for acclimation. You want to do this with all hibernating ants, since the huge temperature change from, in my situation at least, 1 degree Celsius to 25 degrees Celsius is enough to stress a queen to her death in some cases. I instead then placed them into the fridge for a week. But after that, I was finally ready to take a look at my native queens. Now remember, these are last year's catch, so most of them aren't even colonies yet. I will go through them one by one and check on the brood pile as well as the queen. Hopefully, there will be little casualties, which is actually pretty normal for a hibernating queen, sadly. Alright, first one looks like a healthy queen, with a fat gaster. That is a good sign. Awesome. I actually fed all the queens that you will see here with some chicken and honey later on, just to get them going now after hibernation. But as a huge contrast to the first test tube, some test tubes might look as heartbreaking as this one. The queen was dead. But the most sad thing was the little nanitic worker who was tending to her dead queen. This nanitic probably got enclosed by the queen just before she died. This is such a sad setting, and even worse, she had a brood pile with another pupae waiting to hatch. I didn't really record me ending the worker's suffering from her dead queen, but it was actually pretty sad. Even worse, she was actually a Flavius queen, which I would have loved to get a colony of. Well, some die, some live. You can't do much about it. Now to the third test tube, which had a worker. Oh, actually two. This is so awesome. Those workers was born in almost at the temperature of the freezing point of water. Just incredible. And the queen looks pretty healthy. The gaster could have been a little larger, but she will probably get better when she eats some honey. Fourth test tube. The queen looks good and she has two workers. Or actually she probably have three, if you can see those small antennae there. And it looked like she also had brood, judging by that fat larva. Now, the fifth test tube was not as heartbreaking as the second one, but rather disturbing. I first did not see any ants at all, but then I realized that white fungi was actually growing on top of dead ants. So sad. She even had two workers, it looks like. Well, there's nothing you can do about it. The sixth test tube looks better off, but not totally great. She actually had a worker, but another one was dead. On top of that, the queen did not look that great. Her gaster's segments had started to overlap each other, which means, at least in my experience, that she is not good. Just look at some dead queens and you will see why. She was actually one of the queens who loved the honey I offered later on, so she will probably be fine. I sadly did not see any brood in this test tube, which is a bit of a shame, but I'm sure she'll get to it. If you maybe have seen something that I have missed in all of these test tubes, please tell me in the comments, since I absolutely want to know. The seventh test tube was a prime example of a healthy queen. Her gaster was fat, and she had a lot of brood in different stages. Although the cotton was leaking, she had still left her brood there. I don't know if that is a good sign or a bad sign. However, my attempts on moving her to another, new, test tube is not going well. 1 week has actually passed, and she is still in this leaky test tube. Seems like she likes it there, and that is not too bad of a problem. The eighth queen has been busy laying eggs, cause oh god, that is a lot, and I'm really thrilled about it. She looks healthy, brood looks healthy, also a prime example. Now, the ninth test tube was quite fungi infected, which is definitely a bad thing. Despite that, this rather thin queen, which is also a bad sign, has also been super busy laying eggs. Awesome. She was also one of the queens which I have been trying to move to another test tube for over a week now, with no success. I guess she simply is in no need for an upgrade. Now to the 10th test tube. This one is special, because at the time when I caught her, I didn't really realize that she was a parasitic species. probably Lacius Umbratus, but in a brown version. When I realized that, it was too late in the year to get some host brood and workers, because all the wild colonies were hibernating, so that meant she just had to wait until spring, which is now around the corner, so I will surely introduce her to a host colony when the time comes. And now for a special setup. This is in fact also a Lacius Umbratus colony. However, this queen is beautifully orange, and she has host workers. In fact, my third ever video was on this girl, and the introduction of her slave workers. Go watch that video if you want, by clicking here. But first, I just want to say that I totally underestimated the needs of brood and workers for a host colony, and for a parasitic queen. I added in far too few workers and pupa. Again, when the time comes, I will fill her up with slave workers and pupa to get her going again. I made a cocktail of honey and chicken for them to consume, as they are actually my favorite native colony because of the queen is in such a rare morph. Ah, look at them feeding on it, they look so happy. So that was actually all of my Lacius and maybe some Formica colonies, I'm not too sure. Which are not actually colonies yet, but you get what I mean. 2 out of 10 dead out of hibernation. That is a pretty lucky score. I know people who have had 80% casualty when they bring theirs out of hibernation, so don't be too beat down if many of yours are dead. Here's some footage of all the colonies eating of the chicken and honey I talked about. Aren't they just so cute looking? Now, prepare for the weirdest ant story you have ever heard. So, in Sweden, we have it as a tradition to decorate with twigs and mosses from our forests for Christmas. Or at least we who live pretty rural do so. This year was no different, with the table being decorated with 2 meters of moss. This moss was bound to have a lot of insects in it, and I was aware of that. When Christmas dinner came, I sat and collected all the bugs that I saw. There wasn't too many, but some at least. Some weeks later, when I was vacuuming the kitchen, I saw a tiny, tiny ant crawling on the ground. Now, remember that this is in mid-winter, with 1 meter of snow outside, so this was in other words a very rare sight. Lucky was she who did not get swept up by the vacuum machine. She had to come from the moss that we brought in for decorations. I picked her up and realized that she was in fact a queen. Now how awesome wasn't that? To catch a queen ant, not just inside of your home, but in the middle of winter, when it was as much as minus 20 degrees Celsius outside with tons of snow. She was a Myrmica rubra, so she is semi-clustral. If you ever find a queen and you're unsure of their species and if they're semi or fully clustral, it's a good idea to look at their gasters, and semi-clustral queens tend to have a smaller gaster. Not always, but just as a general thumb rule, it is good to know. Now, I actually recently, before I found her, made a small plaster nest for a founding colony, and I thought that she could be the test pilot for this. And lucky me, she had actually laid eggs. Also, I'm really sorry if some of you don't like that I gave her such a big founding chamber, but as I said, she is a test pilot. And I did not really have test tubes at the time, since this was a totally unplanned catch. But still, awesome. Now, let's move on to my non-native species. I've actually bought a new colony of Polyrachis Rastellata. And let's not forget our beautiful messor queens. But first of all, I have to make a disclaimer. I by no means want to encourage you to buy exotic ants instead of catching native queens. Because raising your own queen is so much more rewarding. Now, the reason why I have in fact bought 3 colonies of non-native species are these. Where I live, as I previously said, the native ants need to be in hibernation for half of the year. Now, if you ask me, that is a lot of dead time with no ants around. So I wanted to get some species at least who did not need to hibernate, and that is the reason why I bought the Polyrachis species. The messor species that I have bought have been a dream of mine to keep ever since I got into ant keeping. I know it might not be the most awesome species in most people's eyes, but somehow I just love them. And I actually talked about this in my unboxing video of them. Go check that one out here if you want. Now, with all that said, if you live like me and the native ants hibernate for most of the year, I think it's actually acceptable to buy 1 colony of non-hibernating ants, just to fill all that dead time with something exciting. However, hibernation can actually give you a break from ant keeping, which many people find is pretty nice. Another thing that you have to think about when getting an exotic colony is to do your research. I can't stress enough how important this part is. Always check up on all the information you can find about your species before buying it. Not while they are in transit, you have to do it before, so you're all set when they arrive. Some main things to look out for might be if they sting, spray, or maybe if they have a nasty bite. And also, if they sting or spray, how painful it is. Some species may actually leave you in pain for hours, so you really have to know. Another thing to look for is their required temperature and if you can deliver it for them. And also their required humidity, so you can deliver that for them as well. Also, check up on their average colony size and growth rate. Some colonies might grow super fast and a lot faster than you expected, and might outgrow your setups much faster than you want. Some species even have a max size of hundreds of thousands of workers, and some even greater, so that's also good to know about. Also remember that just because a species is exotic doesn't mean they don't need hibernation. Check up on that too. Many people recommend that you put all ants in a bit colder temperature during winter season to get them to rest for a bit, which I totally agree with. Even my Polyrachis Rastellata, I will actually have a temperature drop when it's rainy season in Thailand, where they come from. Just as a quick side note also, buying exotic ants actually limits you from the releasing them into the wild, which is a great pro for keeping native ants, if they maybe get too big of a colony, or if you feel like you can't keep them for some reason. That's actually one of the reasons why I got into ant keeping, since there was always a backup plan. One more thing, when buying ants from sellers from other countries, make sure to ask other people about that seller, to make sure that they are first of all not scammers, but most importantly that they do not dig up established colonies from the wild, or maybe take them from the trees. This is a huge threat to slow-growing species. For an example, the diacamma genus. Only buy colonies who have been raised from single-caught queens. This is the most sustainable way to keep ants, and we don't want to disturb the ants' huge part in their respective ecosystems, do we? Yeah, I thought so. So keep to colonies that have been raised from single queens to keep the ant-keeping hobby sustainable. Phew, that was actually a lot to go through. However, it is very important that you take all of these factors into consideration when buying ants. But now, let's check up on my messor queens and my new Polyrachis colony. First of all, let's start with the messor. I just picked them out of a 2 months hibernation, which is about what they need. When I picked them out, I acclimated them as well by taking them from the fridge and placing them by my window, where it was slightly warmer. After a week of acclimation, I took a peek at them, and there was really nothing going on. 2 weeks after that, however, the red-headed Messor Barbarus queen had actually got her first nanetic. I knew that she had eggs when I looked at her from the hibernation, but that she had already enclosed her first nanetic, that I could never have imagined. This is awesome though, and it looks like she has more coming. I offered her and her first nanetic some honey water soaked cotton and a small dubia nymph, so that those larvae can grow fast. The Osmani queen, however, has not done as good. At first, I didn't see any eggs at all, but if you look really closely, you can see some spread out eggs in the sand. That's weird, queens most often put the eggs together in a clutch, but this one didn't. Maybe that's also the reason why they have not developed as much as the Barbarus queen has. Oh well, let's hope that it all goes well for this Osmani queen, and that she will get her nanetics soon. I also offered her some honey water, if that now could be the reason why she hasn't laid any more eggs. Now, for what you have all waited for, the unboxing of my new Polyrachis ants. These Polyrachis ants are actually from the species Polyrachis Rastellata, which you probably know about since I posted them a while ago on my Instagram, ants_Scandinavia, link in description. So while you watch me unbox them, I can tell you a bit about the seller and how I did to buy these. These girls were actually bought from a seller in the UK, and he only buys from a set number of trusted sellers from more exotic regions, as Thailand for example, where these were actually bought from. All of those sellers are passionate ant keepers, so they would never dig up a wild established ant colony. And that is what you want, a seller who sells sustainably. Now look how beautiful they are. He was kind enough to ship them in a red test tube to reduce stress, as they don't see red light that well compared to white light, although you don't really see their true beauty from this red test tube. Now I actually got my hands on some of these square test tubes from ant nests. This company is founded by two experienced ant keepers who know the pains of ant keeping and what could be improved. So this product is rather neat. Because this test tube is square, it doesn't roll around, so no need for these boxes as I use. They also come with 3D printed chambers in which the ant nests. This is also neat, because when you feed a large colony, they don't get as disturbed as when you feed them in a normal setup. The water reservoir is made out of just a cotton ball. The idea is to water the tube with a syringe. This is very smart, but I would recommend getting the syringe first, as the hole is super tiny. And that's, by the way, a pretty good thing for an ant colony which has super small workers, Tapinoma for example. Because the hole is so tiny, most syringes won't fit, so be sure to find that first. This was actually a problem for me, as I didn't find a thin enough syringe. Otherwise, it was a great addition to avoid mold and dried out test tubes. One thing I think is bad though, is that the plastic is rather thin and flimsy. It was actually so flimsy that I accidentally broke one of the two they sent me. Well, I hope you learned from my mistake. This is not a major problem, I guess, though something to be aware of when purchasing. The cheap price that they are on now would probably go up if they had better plastics though, so it's not a big deal. But now for the transfer of my Polyrachis to this new test tube. The only way I found out which wouldn't break the test tube, as I accidentally did with one of them, was to use blue tack and use it as a glue between the tubes. This method worked out great, so no worries there. Transferring from a circular to a square test tube is obviously pretty weird, but if you use blue tack, it all goes smoothly. And would you look at that? It's Her Royal Highness herself, the Queen of the Colony. And look at the workers, dragging her into the new nest. It is so fascinating to watch. And you realize that just because the queen is so important for the colony, doesn't mean that she owns them in some way. She is controlled by the workers, and they do what they want with her. To them, she is probably just another brick in the colony wall. A perfect society, with no hierarchy whatsoever. Awesome. So as a conclusion, this product is pretty dope. But not life necessary. You could, in other words, just use the normal glass or plastic round test tubes. However, if you only have one or two colonies, this way it is even easier to care for them. For all of you who sat through this whole video to the end, thank you so much. This video was a long one, and it took even longer to edit, believe me. In the next video, I will introduce this Polyrachis colony to my new tropical vivarium. So stay tuned for that. If you followed me on my Instagram, you probably know this by now. So why don't you all go and follow that at ants_Scandinavia. Believe me, you don't want to miss out on the next video. It is gonna be so awesome. Well, take care, and I will see you scavengers next time. Bye!